Hello, everybody, and welcome to History / Law Bite number 270, dated June 7th, 2021. I'm Walter, your mobile historian and blue-collar scholar. This History / Law Bite is entitled Griswold versus Connecticut, 381 U.S. 479, 1965. Griswold versus Connecticut was the landmark U.S. Supreme Court decision that established the constitutional right to privacy with respect to intimate relationships and bodily integrity, ultimately in the long run, okay? Now, as we begin all Supreme Court decisions, we begin the same way the Supreme Court does. All rise! The Chief Justice and the Associate Justices of the Supreme Court of the United States. Oyez, oyez, oyez. All persons having business before the Honorable, the Supreme Court of the United States, are admonished to draw near and give their attention, for the court is now sitting. God save the United States and this honorable court. Please be seated. So let's get into Griswold versus Connecticut. So this case began in the early 1960s in the state of Connecticut, of course, but its history actually goes back to the 19th century. So in 1879, the state of Connecticut enacted a law which prohibited the use of any drug, medical device, you know, or instrument designed to facilitate contraception, all right? And the whole purpose of the law was to, you know, prohibit and undermine illegitimate sexual relationships, aka fornication and sex outside of marriage. But the irony here is that this law applied to everybody, okay? Using contraceptives was prohibited. Being counseled about them was prohibited. And it didn't matter whether you were married or not. You were still disallowed from officially using contraceptives. This is a nod to traditional Victorian era morality. And by the time, you know, the legal challenges against this law began, only two states had them left, respectively, Massachusetts and Connecticut, all right, by the 1960s, okay? And they were hardly ever enforced. Notice I say hardly, but not completely unenforced, okay? So in 1961, C. Lee Buxton, who was a gynecologist at Yale Medical School, along with Estelle Griswold, who was the director of Planned Parenthood in Connecticut, opened up a birth control clinic in New Haven, all right, with the, you know, specific intent of challenging this Connecticut law under the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. So, you know, as you would expect, ultimately, these two would be arrested and fined, you know, for violating the Connecticut statute, okay? Both Buxton and Griswold were fined $100 apiece, which was a substantial amount of money in the early 1960s, far more than what it is today, needless to say. Okay, so their convictions were affirmed in the appellate courts of Connecticut, the appellate division of the circuit court and the Supreme Court of Connecticut, whereby an appeal was then taken to the Supreme Court of the United States. Now, this law, folks, was very unpopular in Connecticut virtually from the time it was enacted, okay? It was a Comstock law, you know, designed, you know, again, Victorian era morality, laws designed to prohibit sexual immorality, named after Anthony Comstock, okay? And, you know, lots of states had them. So the law was very unpopular. And this case, Griswold versus Connecticut, was not hardly the only time Connecticut's anti-birth control statute had been challenged at the Supreme Court of the United States, okay? First time it had reached the Supreme Court was in the case of Tylston versus Ullman in 1943. But essentially the suit was dismissed because there was no case or actual controversy in the matter at hand, all right? And then 18 years later in 1961, in the case of Poe versus Ullman, which some of you may or may not have heard of, That case, too, was dismissed because of a lack of ripeness, which is a necessary condition for a court to hear and pass judgment on a case. Okay? Now, from Poe versus Allman, we got something very important, though. We got Justice John Marshall Harlan II's very notable and very referenced dissenting opinion. In that case, Justice Harlan's dissent argued specifically that the full scope of liberty guaranteed by the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause, number one, couldn't be found in or limited by the specific guarantees provided elsewhere in the Constitution, and two, it is a natural continuum which, broadly speaking, includes a freedom from all substantial arbitrary impositions and purposeless restraints. Okay? Now, Justice Harlan is one of my favorites, as you know, although I don't agree with him ideologically on everything, as he was on the more conservative end most of the time during his time on the Supreme Court. When he did show off, he showed off and showed out. And his dissent in Poe versus Allman, you know, represented his belief that the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause should be interpreted very broadly to protect areas of non-enumerated liberty. All right? Non-enumerated liberty, essentially liberty and rights that aren't specifically mentioned in the text of the Constitution, but protected, okay, by way of the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause, i.e. substantive due process, okay? And it's rather ironic that Justice Harlan, who was a conservative, would view the Due Process Clause in such an expansive format. You know, normally that's the duty of the liberals, not the conservatives. Conservatives tend to frown on using substantive due process because it is very subjective of a concept and essentially allows judges to define areas of liberty as they see fit, because those liberties are not specifically outlined in the Constitution. As mentioned, it gives judges the power to say, this is a liberty, that is a liberty, that is a liberty, this is not a liberty, that's not a liberty. You get the gist of it, okay? But back to the subject at hand. So, Justice Harlan's dissent here, you know, has been referenced many times, all right, in subsequent cases, all right? So once this case, Griswold v. Connecticut, was appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court, the justices were presented with the following issue. Did the Constitution protect marital privacy rights against state laws restricting a couple's ability to be counseled on contraceptive use, okay? And in a 7-2 decision, the Supreme Court ruled that indeed the Constitution does protect such privacy rights from state interference. In a 7-2 opinion written by the Honorable, the late great Justice William Orville Douglas, all right, Justice Douglas' opinion argued the following points. First and foremost, Connecticut's law criminalizing contraceptive usage violated the right to marital privacy. Okay? Douglas conceded, as is obvious, that the Constitution did not explicitly protect such a right to privacy, or mention the word at all, as a matter of fact. But various provisions in the Bill of Rights contained penumbras, or zones, which rights, in this case, the right to privacy, could be protected, all right, even if it was not specifically enumerated in the text of the Constitution. He specifically rejected, I want to add, all right, he specifically rejected the use of the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause to protect privacy. Why? Douglas was not a fan of substantive due process. You must remember, he came of age in the era when the court was using substantive due process to strike down regulations on working hours and other limitations on businesses. So, in that era, substantive due process was not meant to expand personal freedom per se, but rather the rights of businesses and corporations. So substantive due process was a very discredited doctrine. in the 1960s. And but interestingly enough, this is the era, and in the 70s, when it would arguably make its, you know, renaissance, all right, having been, for all intents and purposes, thrown out in the garbage in the 1930s, all right, in the case of West Coast Hotel versus Parrish, which, you know, officially brought an end to the Lochner era, all right? So, back to this, though, okay? So Douglas specifically refused to use 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause and instead grounded his opinion protecting the right to privacy, all right, in the implied penumbras of privacy in the First, the Third, the Fourth, and the Fifth Amendments to the Constitution, okay? Douglas went on to further reason that the right to marital privacy was older than the Bill of Rights itself, as if he really needed to mention that, okay? And he appealed to the sanctity of marriage in Anglo-American culture and in the common law tradition, all right? And it's interesting here in Douglas's Griswold opinion that he cites several cases in which the court had found and protected the right of individuals to do things that weren't specifically enumerated in the Constitution, but those cases had specifically referenced the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause as the protector of those rights. So, kind of makes you wonder why he used those cases when they are going somewhat, while they go along with his logic, those cases, you know, such as Myers versus Nebraska and Pierce versus Society of Sisters, which were handed down about 40 years before Griswold in the early 1920s, both of those cases used the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause to justify their holding, something that Douglas was loath to use. So he had to use the cases, but not the use the cases as a car per se, but not the fuel that was in the car. All right, so whatever. All right, he had to justify his opinion as best as he could, you know, and you could tell he was climbing, you know, a serious mountain to reach his overall analysis and make it somewhat coherent without using the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause to justify privacy. Okay, so that was his holding, his majority opinion in Griswold versus Connecticut. All right, and based it on the implied penumbras of privacy. All right, in the First, Third, Fourth, and Fifth Amendments to the Constitution. Right, not the 14th, as would be the case in subsequent privacy cases. All right, but everyone didn't necessarily agree with Douglas's logic entirely, or some at all. All right, three concurrences and two dissents were filed in this case. All right, concurrences were filed by Justice Arthur Goldberg, John Marshall Harlan II, and Byron White. Okay, Justice Goldberg's concurrence, which was joined by Chief Justice Warren and Justice William J. Brennan Jr., argued that the Ninth Amendment, which essentially prohibits using the enumerated rights in the Bill of Rights as a pretext to deny other rights not mentioned, all right, deny their existence, he argued that the Ninth Amendment was the best vehicle to ground an opinion on, you know, a fundamental right to marital privacy, even though the Ninth Amendment is not per se a source of rights. The Ninth Amendment is merely a guide on how to read the Constitution. Simply put, the Ninth Amendment is saying you cannot interpret, okay, the Bill of Rights and use it as a pretext to say that other rights do not exist because they're not mentioned here, okay? The Ninth Amendment protects non-enumerated rights that the people have. However, what those non-enumerated rights are for the people to define accordingly, all right? Not the Supreme Court, all right? So, yes, that's something I feel very strongly about. The Ninth Amendment is not a source of rights. And any person who tells you that it is a source of rights, per se, okay, like the Fourth Amendment or the Fifth Amendment or the Sixth Amendment, in my opinion, has a rather distorted view of constitutional interpretation. It's okay. So that's the Ninth Amendment, all right? So the next concurrence was filed by Justice Harlan, okay, who argued that the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause was the best engine, okay, to use all right, to define the fundamental right to marital privacy and protect it from unwarranted intrusion by the state, okay? Largely mirroring his dissent in Poe v. Ullman 4 years earlier, which we just talked about. And last, Justice Byron White concurred only in the judgment of the court, which reversed the Supreme Court of Connecticut here. White adamantly stated that he failed to see the logic in Connecticut's law because he didn't understand, like any rational person, you know, wouldn't understand either, how a law designed to prohibit illegitimate sexual relationships was furthered by prohibiting married couples from using contraceptives. White made a very good point there and also argued that the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause was the best, you know, area of the Constitution to ground the right of privacy, okay, the right to marital privacy with respect to this case, all right? So that covers the concurrences. Now, two dissents were also filed in this case by Justices Hugo Black and Potter Stewart, both who cross-joined each other's dissents. Black's dissent, you know, was classic Hugo Black, who was a textualist and argued very vehemently that the Constitution does not expressly mention the word privacy, and thus the court had no right or reasonable rational basis to strike down Connecticut's law prohibiting contraceptives. You know, he made it clear in his dissent that I like my privacy as much as the next guy. But unless some specific provision in the Constitution prohibits the government from invading it, I have no choice but to concede that they have the power to invade it. All right? So, that was Black's dissent. And Stewart's dissent is perhaps one of the most memorable opinions filed in Griswold because in his dissent, Stewart wrote that the Connecticut statute was an uncommonly silly law. And indeed it was. But the Constitution does not prohibit states from enacting uncommonly silly laws. And if you ever were to Google, let's say, silly state laws, you would get thousands of results. And some states have laws on the books that totally defy any common sense or logic whatsoever. But guess what? The Constitution doesn't prohibit them from enacting them. All right? So those were the dissents. All right? And the judgment, of course, in this case was a reversal of the Supreme Court of Connecticut in invalidating the Connecticut statute, per se. So, the legacy of Griswold versus Connecticut, you know, has been very far-reaching in the 56 years since it was handed down. At the time of this recording, June 7th, 2021, specifically why I chose this day, this is the 56th anniversary of the court's decision in Griswold versus Connecticut, all right? And Griswold has been cited a litany of different times in subsequent cases concerning privacy rights, all right? Privacy for originally just for unmarried couples, but it has also been extended to abortion, juveniles, homosexual relations, and same-sex marriage. Excuse me. So we see Griswold was cited in Eisenstein versus Baird, 1972, you know, for unmarried couples, all right? Roe versus Wade in 1973 for abortion. Carey versus Population Services International in 1977 for juveniles to have access to contraceptives. Lawrence versus Texas in 2003, striking down the very anti-gay sodomy laws nationwide. And Obergefell versus Hodges in 2015, holding that same-sex couples had the fundamental right to marry based on both Due Process Clause and the Equal Protection Clause in the 14th Amendment, all right, legalizing same-sex marriage nationwide. So Griswold versus Connecticut has a lot of descendants that in each case have expanded the right to privacy. Like I said, initially just for married couples, but has extended to the right to privacy for, you know, virtually all aspects and all segments of American society with respect to intimate relations and bodily integrity. Okay? So that is Griswold versus Connecticut, folks. Very interesting and far-reaching privacy rights case. This case established that right to privacy that we are all familiar with today. Okay? Griswold versus Connecticut, 381 U.S. 479, 1965. If you have any questions or controversies, leave them down below. I'll be happy to answer them. If you gained some insight from this video, learned a thing or two perhaps, I hope you did, drop me a like. That's what's appreciated the most. And if you have not already done so, please subscribe to my channel. You know, your support means more than I could ever say. And if you made it this far listening to this whole video and hearing me teach, then I think you probably found something interesting about it. So if you want to keep hearing my videos, subscribe to my channel. Know that I appreciate it. Take care, stay safe out there, and I'll talk to you at the next bite. Peace.